All right, it's time for Heroes Q&A number 31. For the rest of the video, I will talk in a more monotone voice, since I know lots of people like to listen to these as they fall asleep. Heroes Q, I should really change the name of my channel to something besides Harema Red X. That is such a dumb name. That has nothing to do with World of Warcraft. Everything is about WoW. It has to be something else, like Heroes World of Warcraft channel, or the best World of Warcraft videos, the best WoW videos, the best top 10 WoW, the best WoW top 10s. That sounds like a good name. I think a really good name for a channel is one that's intentionally kind of silly and stupid, because it's a lot more memorable. It's great for brand recognition. I don't think you should try to go all super serious about these kinds of things. Unless you have like a super serious channel, which I do not. Also, though, the name is fine in case I ever wanted to do something non-WoW, so I guess I'll just leave it the same. Plus, I'm already growing slowly enough. I don't want to change everything up and then halt in growth. Okay, so let's actually answer questions. First question. Hey, Hero. Oh, sorry. I was supposed to be talking in a more monotone voice. I don't want to control myself. I'm going to use my entertainer voice. Hey, Hero, I got a question for you. Why are you so gay? I'm not gay. I don't know what that's in reference to. I'm not gay. I've never liked men, except for Kyle that one time when I was at work. That's only because Kyle was a very good-looking man. I wasn't really gay for him, but I did write an essay in one of my English classes about him when we had to write a this is for real thing. We had a assignment to write a essay about someone who we thought was a role model or something, or someone we looked up to. And I was like, I never really looked up to anyone. I never really had a positive male role model in my life. I just kind of did whatever I felt like. And I definitely didn't look up to my mother. Probably a combination of various movie figures, you know, taking quotes and everything. I didn't really look up to any one person. This is really hard. How about, instead of thinking about this for reals, I just write it about Kyle from work, because I think that would be hilarious. And I could probably actually write an entire essay about it. So that's what I did. I just wrote about Kyle and how great he is. exaggerated, of course, because Kyle is just a normal guy. He's really nice, too. And I wrote that, and my English teacher obviously gave me full credits, because I've always gotten A's on all my essays. And she also put a note like, wow, you really care about this guy, Kyle. I was like, yep. Sure do. I still think it's funny thinking back on it. I remember I found the essay because I had it like saved in one of my Google Drives, and I reread it, and I was like, eh, this isn't as good as I remembered it. I remember this being a lot better, but it actually just seems like a kind of a typical essay that you could have written about like anyone who just happened to have the name of a coworker in it. But other than that, that's probably the gayest thing I've ever done, and that was kind of a joke. So, next question. What editing program do you use? I use Sony Vegas and After Effects, like, pretty much for every video. Sony Vegas is a really good video editor to, like, just put stuff together and to add text, or to overlay videos, or to add images to videos. It's very fast. Premiere Pro can do the same thing, but Sony Vegas is a lot quicker, and it's a lot more user-friendly. And After Effects, I've heard of people who use After Effects as a video editor, and I remember very recently I found out, like, another YouTuber, I think her name's Proper Bird, she said she only uses After Effects as her video editor, with videos that don't require After Effects at all. Everything she does is very standard stuff that can be done in Sony Vegas or Premiere Pro. And I was like, you're crazy. I think I even, like, typed that out to her. I was like, that is insane, because there is a huge difference between After Effects and a normal video editor that If I were to explain to you, you probably wouldn't get unless you are actually a video editor yourself. But After Effects is like a video creation tool. It is not optimized at all for standard editing. It is 100% optimized for doing very advanced things. You know, I usually just use that for like machinimas or for my lower third stuff, any of the fancy texts I put into my videos. I create all those in After Effects. What I don't do is edit in it because it's a horrible video editor. In order to see, because one of the main things you do when you're video editing is matching what you're talking about in your script to what's shown on screen. So, like, take my previous video I made, like, about Yaniku and Vol'jin. Like, if I'm talking about Vol'jin going to Durotar with Thrall, I'd put, you know, Vol'jin and Thrall on screen with, like, Orgrimmar in the background or something. And in After Effects, if I put the lines in, there's no indication of what's being said. You have to, like, go into an extra step to show the wave files that we can actually see the lines moving for the dialogue. And in order to actually listen to it, you have to, like, pre-render it and then do a playthrough. That way it goes through the video. And then you can see, like, what's being said. And in order to actually put what's on screen to match what's being said, you have to, like, put marks into the video itself or just memorize at the exact points where the lines move in the audio representation, and then you go in and put it in later. And that would be such a pain in the ass to do for everything, because in a video editor, you can just play the audio at the same time you edit. In After Effects, you cannot. That is a huge difference that makes it so much harder. It's actually a huge pain in the ass, too, when you're doing, like, machinimas where you have to match up even more precisely, like, the animations of the guy moving with what they're saying. But in those instances, you're going to be taking a long time doing it anyway, and I've gotten used to it. That was actually one of the biggest things I hated about After Effects at first, was getting used to how you can't listen to audio while you're editing. That is such a huge pain in the ass. I don't know how anyone would do a video editor like that. Also, you can't have two instances on the same timeline. I know I've probably already pulled a whole bunch of people away from this. Let's stop talking about After Effects. It's a great video creation tool. It is not a good video editor, though. Like, if you're making small things, like, even if you would make an entire project in After Effects, like I do for some of my machinimas, I make them, like, one scene at a time, and then I put them into Sony Vegas to edit them together. I'm pretty sure, like, Nixium does that, too, and anyone who does video editing or makes machinimas does it as well, just because that's how terrible of a video editor After Effects is. But it's so necessary for creating anything fancy, because most video editors can't do those kinds of things. So I use both of them. And I also use Photoscape to edit images. Because I tried Photoshop once, or a couple of times, and I didn't really like how it made you do a whole bunch of different steps to do something very simple. Kind of like another reason After Effects is a terrible video editor, because you have to do a whole bunch of different steps in order to do something that's very simple in Sony Vegas. Same thing with Premiere Pro. That's why I prefer Vegas over Premiere Pro, because Premiere Pro isn't as user-friendly. It basically has the same interface as After Effects, except you can actually have different instances on the same timeline, and you can actually listen to the audio while watching the video. Okay, so for the people who are still, you know, watching this video after all that stuff with editing, let's go into the next question. I'm just going to stop it there. My boring life as a mob. Oh, that's a video suggestion. So I had this machinima idea for a guy who dies and then wakes up into World of Warcraft as a level 1 boar, and he has to survive. And I was asking for very catchy names for it. And this is another one. My boring life as a mob. That's a pretty good name for it. I think I already decided on a name. It's going to be called something really long. I think it will be called... Actually, let me look it up real quick. Because I'm drawing a blank on it. Videos to be made. Machinimas. World of Warcraft. No, that's what's going to be called internally. The actual name is going to be I Died and Now I'm a Boar in WoW. No, I Died and Now I'm a Mob Character in WoW. Episode 1. The title gives away what it's about. It's a technique used very often in Japanese light novel industry, where they have very long titles for the names. Like, one of my favorite light novel series, or an anime based on a light novel, the title is literally called My Teen Romantic Comedy Is Not What I Expected. So that's like a 10-word title, and it's literally just like a sentence describing what the thing is about. And there's a lot of other examples like that, and I thought I would do that as my title for it. So I died and I woke up as a boar in WoW, or something similar to that. But internally, I'll call it World of Boarcraft, because that's an awesome name as well. And I might even call that as for the different videos, or I might keep the title. I don't know. I haven't really decided. I do have it like all planned out, and I'll probably start working on it. As soon as I finish last episode of Dave and DevBot, which I'm working on right now. Because I want to finish that up. Next question. Hero, I really need your help. Can you please do a video on the big events after Mr. Pandaria, like Vol'jin's death? Just a recap would be perfect, because I haven't played WoW in a couple of years. I just restarted and I have no idea what's happening in the world of WoW. That's a good idea for a video. Like, a recap of everything that happened in BC. A recap of everything that happened in Wrath of the Lich King. You know, like, just major events that happened. Nothing, like, intricate. So, like, with BC, you would go over what happened with Kel'Thuzad. Not Kel'Thuzad. Kel'Thas. And Lady Vash. And Illidan. And then Kil'jaeden. And then Wrath of the Lich King. You'd go over, like, why Naxxramas was a big deal. And then Ulduar. And then TOC. And then ICC. Everything that happened. And then in Cataclysm, do the same thing. And then Mists, and then Warlords, and that's it. So like 5 videos or something. Good idea. I'll probably do something like that, maybe. Next question. Are the old RTS Warcraft games worth playing today? Or do you think they should remaster them for... Question for Hero and everyone reading. I played Warcraft 3 a little bit just to get footage for a video I was doing. And StarCraft is a lot better. It has like very old controls into it. So if I'm not really a huge fan of RTS games, so you're asking the wrong person. I also didn't play any of the RTS games before WoW. But coming from the perspective of someone who is not a huge fan of RTS games, but has played some StarCraft 2, they're not really worth playing today if you're going back to them, because StarCraft 2 has better controls, because the controls are really bad for Warcraft 3, so I can't imagine how they would be for the other ones. So a remaster would probably be something I'd play. Oh, I think someone's working on a remaster of Warcraft 3, if I remember correctly. I also remember they sent me a beta invite, and I ignored the email like I do everything else. I've been getting a lot of like Steam code emails lately, because usually I get like crappy emails like, hey, we'd like you to join our network. One of them even like confuses me for another YouTuber who has a similar sub count. So it's very obvious that they're just going down like a list of people with, you know, subscribers like in the 90,000s, because they sent me 2 different emails from 2 different people calling me like this random YouTuber who does Team Fortress 2 videos, who has a similar subscriber count as I do. And I thought that was funny. Also, other other emails from other networks. Emails about shitty mobile games. I get lots of those. Like, hey, we'd like to pay you a lot of money to make like a 2 to 3 minute video about our mobile game thing. I remember because I got one of those emails literally this morning. So, yeah, they said like 2 to 3 minutes. Either a video itself or a video inside of it. Or at the end, and also, you know, gold sellers or boosting services. And Steam codes for games. Those ones are cool, though. Like, they say, hey, we have this new game. We'd like YouTubers to make videos on it. Here's an early Steam code for it. I was like, oh, that's neat. You see, those are the kind I like. Too bad I don't actually make videos about random games. Only World of Warcraft, so I'm not going to do it. But I have, like, redeemed a couple of those codes, you know, just to have them on Steam, even though I don't really play Steam games. Alright, we're back. I forgot that talking for a long time dries out my throat, because I'm not used to this. What was I talking about? Oh yeah, the emails I get for my channel. Let's see. Oh, because I was talking about the RTS thing and how they sent me a code for the remaster of Warcraft 3. Or were they calling it Warcraft 4? I don't remember. It looked cool. It's just I don't really care, so I didn't really do anything with it. I think Nixia made a video on it though. All right, anyway, next question. Could you rank the WoW expansions from best to worst? Explain why you put them in that order and why an X-Pack was good slash bad. I made a video like this for my April Fool's Day video. It was the top 10 best WoW expansions. Despite the fact that there aren't 10 WoW expansions, and I left out a number. Because I included Heroes of the Storm and Hearthstone in it. I kind of failed with that video. I keep forgetting that something that's funny for me isn't really funny for someone else, because I sometimes would put jokes into my videos to confuse my fans. That way it would be funny to me and me alone. And then I think, oh, this video is supposed to be funny to the people watching it. They're supposed to be in on the joke, not me putting a joke on them. That way I can be the only one laughing. I don't know how I forgot that. I didn't really even realize I did that until I made that video, because there was a whole bunch of jokes that were just played straight. And I was like, what's the point of this? It's like, oh, it's funny that you thought some of the stuff in the video was a joke when I was actually being serious about it. Haha, isn't that funny? Oh, wait, no, that's only funny to me. It's only funny to me because I intentionally made the video complicated and unclear. Oh, I should probably not do that again. So I think I kind of failed in that video. Some of the stuff in there was fine. I also really like the Hearthstone thing I did. I was thinking about doing Yu-Gi-Oh videos over on my Yu-Gi-Oh channel, where they actually have duels and everything. It'll be called like the Adventures Rescue Cat is Missing, Adventures of Rescue Rabbit, and how Rescue Rabbit tries to duel his way to the Forbidden Realm to rescue his friend Rescue Cat. See, rescue, rescue. I thought that would be a really great scenario in order to make like a little series about Rescue Cat going around and dueling monsters in this vein of the TV show. Just because I saw it in another guy's. There's this YouTube web series I really like called If the Emperor Had a Text-to-Speech Program. It's about Warhammer lore. I didn't know anything about Warhammer until I watched the thing. Because they actually do a really good job of explaining the lore. In fact, that's like part of the series is like the Emperor of the Universe woke up after 10,000 years and he's asking his assistant what happened since the time he passed out 10,000 years ago. And so you learn about the lore through him as the Emperor learns it. And anyway, there was one episode where he duels the Emperor in a game of Yu-Gi-Oh! Just randomly, it's literally Yu-Gi-Oh! And they play it, and I was like, oh, this was really funny. I actually kind of like this. I should probably go back and watch the entire series because I just saw that one first because someone linked it on Reddit. And they also had a very recently, they had another one where he dueled like a chaos god for someone's soul. And they played Yu-Gi-Oh! And he played a Morphine Jar 2 mill deck. And I thought that was a really well done episode. I was like, oh, I should totally do something like this of my own, because it doesn't seem like it's that hard to do. But that's on my Yu-Gi-Oh! Channel, so you guys probably won't ever see that. Next question. Where was I at? Oh, I kind of just didn't answer the question, so I talked about my April Fool's Day video. Whatever. Hero, could you put timestamps in this video? Don't take this the wrong way. I love your content, but 1/30H is much for people. 1/38, 130 hours? I assume he's saying the video is too long, which I agree, it is very long. But I don't want to put timestamps in because these videos are very low effort for me. And I kind of like how little effort I put into them. And putting timestamps in would mean I'd have to go through and watch the video again after it's uploaded in order to put timestamps into everything. Which seems like a pain in the ass for me, so I don't want to do that. So next question, could you. Oh, I already missed that one. Next question. Is liking traps gay? What was your thoughts on the single best anime slash manga ever made? JoJo's Bizarre Adventures. Oh, it looks like this got cut off. And was the Boar story a shit Konosuba reference? And what do you think of Pan Pizza? You mentioned his podcast. So this is four questions in one. First one, is liking traps gay? No. There's nothing gay about that. You see, for those of you who aren't part of the anime community, a trap is a very feminine-looking male. Like, they're literally a female, but then you learn, oh, I'm actually a guy. Even though I look like a girl, I talk like a girl, I act like a girl, but actually I'm a guy. And that's why it's called a trap. So is liking a trap gay? There's nothing gay about liking someone who acts like a girl, looks like a girl, and is basically a girl. You never know, they might have a feminine penis. I could never say that without laughing in these things. See, this is why people ask if I'm gay, because of the whole feminine penis thing. A feminine penis is a joke. It started on 4chan or something about how liking traps isn't gay and if they have a feminine penis. And the joke is there's no such thing as a feminine penis. it's a whole inside joke. It doesn't exist. It's an oxymoron. But I think it's funny. Because it's a funny oxymoron. I don't know if oxymoron is the word to describe it, but it sounds like it is. It sounds like it fits in this scenario, what I'm talking about. Next question in Hitside, this one question. What was your thoughts on the single best anime / manga ever made, JoJo's Bizarre Adventures? I don't think JoJo is the best anime / manga ever made, but it is a really good one, so I can't really fault you on that. That'd be like saying Death Note's the best anime ever made. I wouldn't say that, but it is a really good one. So what are my thoughts on it? It's a really good one. If you watch the Melancholic Adventures of Inzoth video, when the series is complete, you'll notice a lot of JoJo references. So if you've watched JoJo's Bizarre Adventures, you'll understand a lot of the references, because I like to put lots of anime references in my machinimas. And next one, was the Boar a story, a shit Konosuba reference? The Boar story, no, not really. But kind of. Because you see, Konosuba is an anime about a guy who dies in real life and then wakes up in like in a fantasy world where it's kind of like an RPG. Except for the fact that that describes like a million different animes and mangas. There are literally so many of them. It is insane with that same exact premise, except with like slight variations to it. Konosuba is an anime exactly like that, except it kind of makes fun of the genre because it's been overdone so much. Kind of like SAO, that's probably the most popular example of it. Except, you know, that one, they're actually in a game. And Konosuba is just a really funny parody of that genre. That it's, like, very specific to Japan. And, yes, that's what the Boar story is based off of. But there's literally so many of them that unless you're, like, really into that kind of thing, like, if you know a lot about anime and manga, you probably only know about the more mainstream references, so it kind of sounds like Konosuba because that's the most mainstream run recently. And what do you think of Pan Pizza? You mentioned his podcast. Oh, I love Pan Pizza. His videos are legitimately really good on his channel. I think it's called, I don't know what they're called. Just type in Pan Pizza and you'll find his videos. They're really well-edited, well-researched, just like reviews on random shit, like video games or old TV shows and stuff. Real interesting stuff. He also has a podcast, which is a pretty good podcast because it's just him and some of his friends. Some of them are other YouTubers. Sometimes he gets like really important guests on. Sometimes he gets really big other YouTubers onto his podcast, which is kind of crazy. I don't know how he gets them. He probably just asks. Because his podcast, they mainly just talk about cartoons. Like American cartoons. You know, like Steven Universe and stuff like that. Or Powerpuff Girls. But he also has like a Let's Play channel that he started actually making videos for again recently this year. And you should go watch his Toy Story Let's Play. He just Let's Plays a whole bunch of random licensed games. That he plays on emulators or something. And you have to watch his Toy Story 1. That one is his best. Because he just talks about how pathetic he is, because he makes a whole bunch of jokes in his videos and his podcast about how pathetic he is. It's like, haha, that's just a character he plays. And then I started watching his Let's Plays, specifically the Toy Story one. I was like, oh my god, he's not joking. he's serious about everything he jokes about. Wow. Oh man, you have to watch it. Just, I seriously, go watch his Toy Story Let's Play. It's so good. I mean, I guess he is playing the video game, but it's not really for the video game. It's more about his commentary. He plays the video game and then he just talks about something completely unrelated. Kind of like my Q&A videos. That's a good estimation of what his Let's Play channel is like. Especially his Toy Story one. Toy Story 1, I think he also did a different Toy Story game. But it's not as good as the first one where he... Maybe I'll link it. I don't know. I'll probably forget. Next question. Other than money, is there anything keeping you into WoW or Yu-Gi-Oh? Other than money? I mean, besides the fact that I enjoy both of them? I mean, there are some times where I don't really care for WoW or Yu-Gi-Oh as much as I used to, and I definitely keep doing it because it's my job to make videos on those things. Like, for Yu-Gi-Oh, sometimes I go through moments where I just don't really care about the game. And then I'll get super into it. Like, right now, I'm into a phase where I'm really into the game, and I'm really enjoying making decks, but sometimes it's like, I don't really want to play Yu-Gi-Oh. I'd rather do something else. I go through phases, and I just kind of force myself to do it. And then when I force myself into it, I kind of get into it. So it's never really a slog. Like, it's more, I'm just not really into it that much. And then when I do get into it, I get into it. And I actually start enjoying myself, even if I had forced myself into it at first. Because I do legitimately like them. It's not like if I was doing a very boring, mundane task and I forced myself to do it and I just hated it. Like when you're doing chores, you have to force yourself to do them, and then while you're doing them, you don't actually like doing it. It's not the case. I force myself into playing Yu-Gi-Oh! And then I enjoy it because it's actually kind of fun. With WoW, that's not really the case, because unlike the Yu-Gi-Oh! Videos, I don't actually have to play WoW in order to make WoW videos. In fact, I haven't been making many videos recently because I've been playing WoW so much. I've been really into leveling up my paladin and gearing out my mage, which takes up a lot of time that could have been spent actually making videos about the game, so it's a huge difference between the two. Oh, plus the money thing. Well, do you guys know ad revenue is really low right now? Usually a good indication of how much you make is, like, how much money you make per 1,000 views. Like, total. Usually I make about $1 to $2 per 1,000 views. So, you know, like $1.50 per 1,000 views is a good average of how much I usually make. It varies widely, and it's usually on the lower end towards $1. But ever since the whole controversy with all those major ad people pulling out of YouTube, for the beginning of this month, I was actually making, I'd say, about 75 cents per 1,000 views. Like, on the high end, it was really bad. Like, I think I took a 50% pay cut because of how bad the ad revenue was. Luckily, I have a lot saved up. Ad revenue seems to be going back up again. Even at $1, that's usually terrible, because that's like the ad revenue for January through like March, where no one's buying ads on YouTube, but this was even worse. Usually in April, the ad revenue starts picking back up towards the $2 mark. So I was making even less than January, which is crazy, like a 50% pay cut. But I'm fine right now. I forgot what I was talking about. In the middle of that, I had a huge coughing fit because my throat was so dry. So what was I talking about? I think I was complaining about low ad revenue. Oh, it's been going back up. It's not that bad. What my biggest concern was, if it kept going lower, then I would be in bad. It would start being bad news, because a 50% pay cut, I can still pay my bills with that. That should tell you how much I've been making. Not a lot. I don't make a lot of money. I just have very cheap bills to pay because I intentionally live below my means, because I plan for worst case scenario. Plus, I was already super poor before I started making money on YouTube. Like, oh my God, I had no money. I lost so much weight because I had like a $10 budget of food for a week. You know how hard it is to eat for an entire 7 days on $10? Not that hard, and if you don't mind tuna and ramen noodles every day. Luckily, though, I can pay as much as I want in food now. That's basically where all of my splurging goes, is food. Other than that, I don't really waste my money on anything, so I just save it all because I have to pay taxes. Like, I had to pay taxes recently because, you know, if you're working for yourself, you have to watch out for taxes. Luckily, when I first started doing YouTube videos, I heard horror stories about people who spent all their money and didn't have enough to pay back their taxes. And I was like, well, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to start saving immediately. So when tax season came around, I paid that no problem. And I still have a lot of money left over, so where basically if I made 25% of what I usually do, you know, a 50% more pay cut than what I already took, then I might be in trouble a year from now. But like I said, ad revenue is going back up, so it's not really a big deal. There are some of the YouTubers who worried, kind of freaked out, and were like, oh no, I can't do this, we're making no money. Patreon, support us on Patreon right away. And I thought, that's probably something I should do as well, but I'm gonna wait this out a little bit to see if it gets worse. Because if it's just this, I can live with it, but it's gonna kind of suck. But then again, I am still growing, so I'll be getting more views, but getting paid less for those views. Well, in the end, it'll kind of even out. But I was just worried about it shrinking more, and it seems to already hit the plateau and it's going back up again. So the Patreon thing, I don't really need to push that. I kind of like Patreon though, because I put a whole bunch of rewards on there to make it actually worth money. And I put them all towards like the really low end because I'm a huge believer in like having a lot of people pay a tiny bit of money instead of having a couple of people pay a lot. So if there's going to be donations, I'd rather have like 100 people donating $1 than like 10 people donating $10. I'm big on the whole crowdfunding thing from small amounts from people. So, I like to put all my rewards at the smaller ends. And on that front, I think I actually have like 20 Patreons, which is not half bad, considering I don't really advertise it much. Except for that thing where I did last week, where I accidentally uploaded one of my Patreon rewards publicly. Because you see, for the $3 reward tier, I have this thing where whenever I upload a video, a couple days after it's up, I'll make a second video. Or I basically just talk over the video and talk about the behind the scenes or what went into it. And I talk about criticisms of the videos from the comments or what went wrong, what went well, what people liked and everything. You know, lots of in-depth stuff, kind of like D&D commentary things. Specifically, it's just a Patreon reward because I thought it would be like, you know, like a D&D commentary thing. It's not really super important, but you know, maybe some people might like it. And the thing is, I made two of them at the same time. One for the Enzoth video, where I talk about the behind the scenes of the first episode of that, and then one for the top five starting zone videos. And I put them up both to upload at the same time, both of them sent to unlisted. And after it uploaded the Enzoth video and it started working on the second one, because I'm used to uploading videos in batches, my Firefox browser crashed. Like, it just had a straight up critical failure, and I had to open it back up. And it's like, we reset everything. I was like, holy shit, I've never had a crash this bad before. So it logged me out of everything, but luckily, I still had all my bookmarks, and it still remembered all my passwords, because I pay for this thing that gives me protection. So I just had to log back into everything, but it was kind of a pain in the ass not having. Because, like, whenever I open up a new tab, it'll have, like, this thing that has like all of my most viewed websites, and I can just click on those, you know, to go to like Facebook or Twitter or Reddit and everything, and that was completely reset. I was like, ugh, it's gonna take it forever to remember what websites I like to go to the most. I'm gonna have to go through my bookmarks again, like some kind of savage. But anyway, it crashed out while I was uploading the top five starting zones behind the scenes video. So I was like, okay, I'll just re-upload it. So I went to the thing and I just uploaded it again, and I see that I accidentally set it to scheduled. A scheduled upload is where you upload the video to YouTube, and you can set a time and date for it to upload on. And I do that for my Yu-Gi-Oh! And Pet Battle channels, because I usually make a couple of those videos a day, like at a time. Like whenever I make a Yu-Gi-Oh! Video, I'll make like two or three of them at a time, and then I'll just set them to upload, you know, one a day for like the next 3 days. So I know that how the schedule thing works. I use it all the time, and I was like, oh shit, if it's scheduled, it's gonna put it out on public. Also, if it's scheduled, I can't put it on Patreon because you won't be able to watch it, because while it's scheduled to upload, it's unviewable. It's counted as a private video, and I really wish it had an option for it to be viewable as unlisted, because when it's unlisted, if you have the link, you can watch the video, but you can't see the video without the link, so you can't go on my channel page and look through my uploads to find it. But if it's in a playlist, you can go there and watch it too. So that's what I do. I just upload the video as unlisted, and I just put the link onto Patreon, and they can just watch it there. And I also put them all in a playlist that I'll link with it. So anyways, I accidentally set it to scheduled, and then I set it to unlisted. And apparently it didn't save correctly or something, because when I was reading at night, I checked my Twitter, and there's like a bunch of people liked, you know, the video. I was like, oh shit, nobody likes the video from my Patreon page. In fact, the reason I stopped doing them for the longest time is because no one was actually watching the behind the scenes thing. Like, there's a whole bunch of people who could watch them, but none of them actually did, because the videos would have like one or zero views, even though there was like 10 people who had the option to actually watch them. And I was like, well, if I'm doing all this and no one's watching it, I'm probably just going to stop, because it's not like they care anyway. And then recently I went back to it, was like, well, what if all the new people want to do it? I should be doing them anyway, just in case. That way people who pay the $3 tier can actually go back and rewatch all of them if they want, or if I ever decide to put them all public one day. It would be nice just to have them all, so I just started doing them again. And it turns out it was accidentally set to public, and when a video is set to public, it gets posted on my Twitter, and that's when I made the connection. I was like, oh shit, this is a public video. So I went in, and I immediately set it to unlisted, and it had already been out for 2 hours, and it had a whole bunch of dislikes. Like, wow, this is the video that was just out a couple days ago. And I had to put a thing like, oh, sorry, this video wasn't supposed to be public. And I think the video got like 2,000 views in the 2 hours it was out, which is kind of surprising. I was like, dang. It wasn't positively reviewed, because it's a very low effort video. I make them in a way where I specifically don't have to do any editing. I literally just record myself watching the video, and I pause and I rewind. And then as soon as I'm done with that, I just upload it with no editing, which is great. That's what makes it a real easy anime. That's what makes it a really easy reward to fulfill. Even though it sounds, you know, I'm making extra content for the for Patreon that no one will be able to see, it's really not that great. It's just like behind the scenes stuff that no one really cares about. Oh, well, I thought there was a bug on my arm. Next question. Let's see, are you looking for an editor, ? I would love an editor, just to have someone make videos for me. I'll give them a script, and it's like, you have a week to turn this into a video. That would be great. But as it turns out, I don't really have enough to pay an editor a reasonable salary, and people who work for free generally, don't work out, because for one thing, I don't have people edit for free. I always pay them something, just because there's a lot of work that goes into editing, and I know people will offer, and I turned them down, because editing takes a lot of work. It's work, and if you do it for free, that's just something you do in your free time, and well, people don't always have free time, and eventually they flake out, and even the people I do pay, I don't really pay them that much. And then they flake out too, because they find out how much work editing is, and I really don't want to train another editor. And I also don't have the money to afford a real, like, experienced editor. So, am I looking for an editor? Sure, I'd like an editor, but I don't really have the money to pay for one right now. Unless I pay them very little. And in which case, I don't want to deal with the headache that comes with paying working with an inexperienced editor. Because I've already had four of them flake out on me, and I don't want to deal with that anymore. I'm just kind of tired of it. In fact, I'd really just like to hire someone to deal with that for me, so I don't have to deal with editors anymore. Next question. You live in AZ too? I would flip if I met you. Yeah, me too, since I never leave my house. Next question. What is the big deal about showing your face? Not really a big deal on your end. Most people like to know what someone looks like when they watch their videos. Surprisingly, this question is asked a lot. I don't know why. I don't like to see people's faces. I saw recently that that one YouTuber, Blue Yeller, he makes great videos. I like his videos and stuff, but recently he's been putting his face, like a little thing of his face in all of his videos where they don't belong. It adds nothing to his video, and I just can't get past it. It's like, oh my god, why do you do this? And then I probably think, well, I have people ask me all the time why I don't show my face, so it's probably him just listening to his fans. He's probably literally just giving his fans what they want. Me, personally, I think that's stupid. I don't like it. But I can understand why he does it, because he probably gets asked a lot, and he probably gets lots of compliments about it. And I just don't like it. I think it's dumb. But it seems to be a thing a lot of people do like, since I get asked all the time. That's probably it. The kind of videos I do don't require me to show my face. So I'm not going to, and I actually don't like to see other people's faces in their videos too, unless the video, you know, like, requires them to show their face. Because there are some channels like that, like, you know, when they do physical comedy or, you know, like they're a vlogger or something. Yeah, so anyways, I get asked that all the time, so I guess I should probably just answer it in every Q&A instead of every other one, since I've probably answered that question more than anything else in all of my Q&A videos, and while I'm streaming, I get asked a lot as well. So I can understand why people would be pressured into doing it. I personally don't like it. It's a preference of mine. Alright, next question. Man, this is really drying out my throat. I'm only halfway through this, and I'm already on my second water bottle. Okay, where was I at? What is the big deal? Hey, Hiro, do you watch Vsauce? Yes, I do. But I don't really have strong opinions on him one way or the other. He seems like a nice guy, though. Next question. Why doesn't he have the sexy voice like this, like his other videos? Unsub, unlike, unview. You were probably watching a Q&A video in which I use my real voice, which I can't maintain for long periods of time, and unscripted things like my Q&A videos or my streams. My real voice is very monotone, and I have to purposefully put some emotion into it for my videos. So it's almost like I'm voice acting or something whenever I make a video that's highly edited. So in these ones where I'm not voice acting, it sounds a lot different since I don't use my real voice. Because I used to use my real voice in my earlier videos, but I got complaints all the time that I sounded like I was bored. I was like, I'm not bored, that's just how my voice sounds. And then I started experimenting with other different voices, and the complaints disappeared, and in fact I started getting compliments. In fact, I have a bunch of people tell me they subscribe because they liked my voice. I was like, oh, so you like my fake voice. Yeah, I get that a lot. and I can't really maintain that for long periods of time because my throat is hurting from talking normally for half an hour. Next question. Oh, this next question is a series of 7 questions. I'm always afraid that I'm too close to my mic and I might be breathing into it. Because I do that for my behind-the-scenes videos. I can't really go in and edit those out because I don't edit those videos. Part 1 of this question, sub or dub? For those of you who don't know what that means, it means you like subtitles in anime or dub, where they're put into your native tongue. Like, they redo all the lines in English. I like both. I do prefer dub, though. Because if an anime is in English, that means I can watch it while I play Diablo or something. Or while I'm playing WoW. That means I can actually have it on my second monitor while I do something else. But if it's in subtitle in Japanese, I have to actually pay attention to it and watch it. And that's how I watch a majority of my anime, just because that's what a majority of anime is. It's subtitled. Also, not all dubs are good. In fact, I'd say about half of all the dubs I watch, anime in English, has terrible voice acting. Like, it's just really bad. Like, one of my favorite animes, The World God Only Knows, has a terrible English voice acting cast for the women in there. The guy sounds fine, but a lot of the females in, like, the first couple episodes sound like they just picked up girls off the street and, like, hey, record these lines for us. We don't care that you suck at voice acting. So it's kind of hit or miss with dubs. Sometimes they're good. Sometimes they're better than subs. Sometimes they're better than the original Japanese voice actors. Like for Bakano, that's a really good example of an anime that's better in English than it is in Japanese. But that's more of an exception than the rule. Next question. FAM, Fullmetal Alchemist 2003, Conqueror of Shambhala, FMA Manga, FMA Brotherhood, and the movie for the series. It's a better way of watching Fullmetal Alchemist than to not acknowledge the first series. I understand that Brotherhood is the manga adaptation, but could you not lead astray newcomers? Okay, so this is actually I wouldn't say it's hotly debated. It's a debated topic in the anime community. You see, for Fullmetal Alchemist, there's two series for it. There is the original 2003 series and the remake of Brotherhood, which was like in 2006 or 8, I don't remember which. And both of them are considered good, but they're both different. And they both follow the same plot structure up to like the first 10 episodes, and then they go into two different directions. Because the first one was made while the manga was still ongoing, and then they caught up, and the manga went on hiatus or something. Which means they took a break. So like, oh crap, we can either cancel the anime or just make up our own ending. So that's what they did, and it is actually not half bad. And then Brotherhood was a remake, since the first Fullmetal Alchemist and the manga did so well, they're like, how about we just remake the anime to follow the manga exactly, from start to finish, and that's what Brotherhood was. And there's a debate, like, well, should you only watch Brotherhood, since that follows the manga perfectly? Or should you also watch the original one, the 2003? Since that one was also good and an influential anime in its own right. Well, I've watched both of them, and I prefer Brotherhood. It's way better. The reason this is a debated topic is because both animes are both considered really good. And in fact, Brotherhood is always like in the top 10 animes on like all anime rating sites, because it's just like a perfect anime. It is very good. But the 2003 version isn't really, because it has a weird-ass ending, and so does the movie. And I don't recommend it. Unless you're a fan of Brotherhood, which I do recommend, wholeheartedly. And they're like, well, you should probably watch the 2003 version first, since that one came out first before Brotherhood. And I think, no, watch Brotherhood. It's a lot better. 2003 is a good anime too, but Brotherhood is like masterpiece levels. It's so much better. 2003 is just kind of weird. So I take a strong opinion that Brotherhood is the better version. But, I mean, if you're a fan of Fullmetal Alchemist, the 2003 version is kind of like a fan fiction. It's like, what if these things happened instead? And it's okay. It's enjoyable. Brotherhood is like 10 times better, though. And I don't agree with the anime community at large that you should watch the 2003 version first, because Brotherhood's a lot better, and there's no need to. Next question. Are you a firm believer that good anime is only possible if it is a direct adaptation of the manga? Being part of both circles / demographics, I personally judge anime on its own merit rather than whatever it's behind. That's kind of what I do too. You have to judge anime based on its own merit and not what it's based off of. Because sometimes the anime will improve upon the manga. I'm trying to think of an example, but I can't really think of one at the moment. Because most of the times, if I liked an anime, usually the manga would be good too. I'm trying to think of one where I didn't like the manga, but I like the anime. Because it's usually the other way around, where I didn't like the anime, but I like the manga. Like Tokyo Ghoul. That's a good example of a terrible anime adaptation, where the manga is actually decent. But yeah, you should probably just judge anime on its own merit. Even if it's based off of something, because very few anime is not based on something. Because usually anime is not very profitable in itself, and it's more of a way to advertise a product. Like, when you make an anime based off of a manga, it's to advertise the manga, because manga is cheap to make and produce. So there's higher profit margins on anime, which is not cheap to make or produce. so it's basically a huge advertising tool, since it's not very profitable on its own. That's why there's very few original anime only that's not based on something, because they don't do very well most of the time. Unless you get really lucky, like Madoka Magica. That's a good example of an original anime that did very well. But those are more of the exceptions in the rules, and those aren't even really done all that often in the first place. So, it's like a huge outlier. Not all animes are Madoka Magicas. Next question. Have you watched Boku no Pico in school days? No. I know of both of them because they're both very infamous, you know, famous for a bad reason in the anime community. Boku no Pico is usually used as an example to, if you want someone to watch a very bad anime, because it's about a little boy getting raped or something. And School Days is like a standard anime where a guy gets a whole bunch of girls. Except it has a very good ending where one of the girls finds out that the guy was cheating on him, and she kills him and kills the girl and cuts off his head and puts it in a bag and takes it on a boat and sets it on fire and kills herself. When the rest of the anime wasn't horror at all, it was a rom-com, basic rom-com. That'd be like if the end of Friends had one of them killing all the other ones and putting their bodies in a bag and then killing themselves. You know, and a show that's all about comedy and, you know, relationships, all of a sudden have a very dark, twisted ending. That's what School Days is. I haven't watched it, but only because I hear that the first parts of it before the twist ending aren't very good. But I know of it because it's talked about a lot for its very surprise ending. Next question. You obviously have other channels to fall back to, but... For the sake of argument, imagine that that Live WoW was getting shut down tomorrow for whatever reason, and the private servers slowly disappear. What other audience would you look for if WoW content was no longer your main possible focus? Would the Roma Red X channel just die, or would you convert it into a general gaming for the sake of paying your bills? I think I kind of answered this at the very beginning of the Q&A. Yeah, I would just transition it to general gaming. I would do what I do now, but for other games. That's basically it. I don't really worry about that at all. Next question. Do you consider staying at home and doing whatever you feel like as being lazy, despite your work habits that you've already mentioned in previous Q&As? Do I consider staying at home and feel like I'm lazy? You see, there's a fundamental underlying assumption being made there, and that being considered lazy is a bad thing. I've never really cared if people thought I was lazy. In fact, I would try to go out of my way to give off that feeling like, yes, I'm very lazy, and yet look at all this work I still get done anyway. Why work harder when you can work smarter? Everything I do is to be more lazy. But I'm not lazy. I do kind of work hard, but I would really like to not work hard. In fact, one of my most common jokes I used to tell people I knew before I started doing YouTube was, all I want to do in life, my biggest goals, is just to marry someone who will take care of me so I can play video games all day, not have to work. It doesn't have to be a guy. I mean, it doesn't have to be a girl. It could be a guy, but, you know, I would prefer if it was a woman. And in fact, I kind of am jealous that women get this option in life by default, and that it's kind of weird for a man to aspire to be a stay-at-home person who obviously doesn't do any housework either, just plays video games all day. That is my ideal lifestyle, is just to be able to stay home and play video games all day. I don't really say that anymore, and I even said it as kind of a joke back then. But, you know, it wasn't entirely a joke. That would be totally cool. I'm not gay, though. I was just kidding about the other thing. That was more of a joke as well. There's nothing to put you more... What's the words I'm looking for? Nothing makes you seem more confident in your sexuality than to joke about your sexuality. So that's why I would do that. Because I don't really care if people call me gay. I also wouldn't really care if I was gay. I'm not. Kyle showed me that I didn't really care that much about him. Even though I get asked a lot, and I do have weird opinions about traps and feminine penises, but that's all in jokes. It's just jokes. As long as you say no homo, it's not gay. But let's go back to the question. Do you consider staying at home and doing whatever you want feel like is being lazy? Sure. And I don't really mind that. Because I don't care if people... correction. I'm totally fine with people thinking I'm lazy, that I stay home all day. And in fact, I like to brag about it every chance I get. Whenever people talk about having to go to work, it's like, oh my god, I have to go to bed early because I have to work tomorrow. They're like, you work from home. And I was like, I do. You know, just to rub it in that I have a great job. Every chance I get, I do that. So that's not really a problem for me, in the fact that it would be for a normal person who probably worries about other people thinking they're lazy. Because that's just not something that's a concern to me. In the slightest. Next question. The word you're looking for to describe yourself... Oh, wait. Let me try that again. The word you're looking for to describe yourself because you love both anime and manga games is otaku. But I could be wrong. Oh my god. Okay, so lots of people in the anime community like to refer to themselves as an otaku, because otaku was a Japanese word for someone who likes anime and manga. It's a derogatory term. It's usually meant as like the English equivalent of someone who's a nerd or a geek. And it has lots of negative connotations attached to it, like they're a forever alone virgin who lives in their mom's basement. And lots of anime people like to call themselves otaku, you know, just like how lots of nerd people like to call themselves nerds, and that's fine. You know, it takes away the negative connotations from it when you say it. But I don't really like that, because I instead like to call myself a dirty weeb, because that's an even lesser version of otaku. A weeaboo is someone who likes anime and manga but is also super annoying about it. I'm pretty socially adept, and I know how to have normal conversations with people. And part of having normal conversations with people is to not go on and on about an obsession of yourself when you know the other person doesn't care. If the fact that I like anime or manga comes up in a conversation... I'll probably inquire as to if they're interested in it as well, and if I get a good vibe that they're not really, I'll simply change the conversation to something else without harping on it. But a weeaboo is someone who's just really annoying, and in fact, the complete opposite. Someone with no social skills, and is very annoying, and probably uses games and manga as an escape from their poor social skills. So instead, I like to call myself a dirty weeaboo, if I'm being derogatory about it. Otherwise, I don't really like to put a label on myself for anything. I'm just someone who likes anime and manga, but I also like a whole bunch of other things. I like to try new things. I'm open-minded about a lot of things. I just happen to enjoy anime and manga, along with a whole bunch of other things. If someone were to call me an otaku, I'd be like, that doesn't really describe me because I'm a complex creature and I don't like to be described by stupid little terms like that. And I prefer weeb because it's a lesser version. If you're gonna go derogatory, you might as well just go for whatever is the lesser thing. Next question. Hey, Hurama Red X, what's your political view? No. I don't like politics. I don't like people who talk about politics. I specifically will mute people on Twitter or Facebook if I'm following them because I'm friends with them or something and they talk too much about politics. I will hide their feed. Cool thing about both Twitter and Facebook is that you can follow someone or be friends with them and just mute their feed so you don't ever see anything they post in case they post a lot of crap. Because I do have people that I don't agree with politically that I follow or are friends with. I also have people who I do agree with politically that I'm friends with and follow. And I'll mute both of them because I don't like to live in an echo chamber of people repeating the things I believe in. And I also don't really care for people saying the opposite view. Or just be moderate at all. If you talk about politics, I don't care. And I'm going to mute you because I don't want to hear it. I don't care. Everybody is a political expert. It's, for some reason, it's an acceptable thing for everyone to have their own opinion on politics. Oh, that sounds wrong. You can have whatever opinion you want. It seems to be accepted that people think everyone should know about their opinion on politics as well. I was like, I don't give a shit. I don't care about your uninformed opinions. You don't want to hear my uninformed opinions. Everybody knows a lot less about this topic than they really think they do, because it's a very complicated thing. And I don't want to hear people go off and on all... you know what? I'm just rambling now. I mute people who talk about politics a lot, even if I agree with them. And in fact, I usually... you know, obviously you'll be friends with people that you agree with most of the time. So I've blocked more people that I agree with politically than the opposite. In fact, I can only think of one person who I followed, and then I eventually had to unfollow them because they just wouldn't shut up about politics. Not because I didn't agree with them, because I didn't, but because they just wouldn't shut up about it. They would just go on and on. It's like, oh my god, I don't care. And I've also unfollowed a lot of more people who I did agree with politically because they would just go on and on about it. It's like, oh my god, I don't care. So that's my political view. Politics are stupid. I don't care about them. And I'd rather if people would just shut up about them because people would be like, oh, but politics is, you know, the world around you. You can't be ignorant about it. And it's like, I know enough. You guys are the stupid ones who talk about it all the time, like as if you can do anything about it. I'm sorry, are you a lobbyist? Do you work in Congress? I don't think so. You probably don't even vote. I know I don't. next question. It's called Omniscient, not Omniscient. It probably is. Well, I can't expect you to understand pronunciations all that well when you can't even pronounce my name. Even with all the instructions I gave you. Edit. Also, since Mozart is omniscient, he should break the fourth wall, as he should know he's in a show. Unless you already have, when I wrote this comment and I hadn't watched the entire thing yet. Okay, so this is in reference to a character in my Dave and DevBot series. His name isn't Mozart, it's Beethoven, but I understand what he means because they're both famous piano players. He's a character who knows everything, and I probably mispronounced omniscient in the video. Because I probably am saying it wrong right now, too, even with his pronunciation of it. And he should break the fourth wall. I'm pretty sure he does, like, all the time. If he knows everything, obviously he knows that he's in a show. But I think the ones where he really breaks the fourth wall and talks about the fact that he's in a show were in deleted scenes that's on Patreon. Or actually, I think I linked him at the end of the episode. At the end of season 2, episode 2, where Beethoven and Jim just talk to each other, I should have a link at the end of the video about the deleted scenes where I deleted like 4 to 5 minutes of them talking about extra stuff just because I thought it was, the video was long enough as is. It was going to be like a 10 minute long video of them just talking with nothing changing in the background. I was like, this is going to piss off a lot of people. I should probably cut out a lot of it. And in some of the cut out dialogue, there's a lot of fourth wall breaking. So you just go there. It used to be behind Patreon. I think it still is, but it's also viewable through a link at the end of that video. I think I went back in and just like, and you guys can watch it at the end of this video if you want. Next question. Hiro, are you ever going to make Black Desert online content? You can't stake your career on just WoW. Also, the most fun way to level on retail is Battlegrounds. I killed so many human hunters. Oh, I used to do Battlegrounds all the time at low levels before they gave experience. Like, literally, a couple months after I hit the max level, they added Battleground experience. I was like, oh my god. I would have hit max level so much sooner if they had Battleground experience, because I did so many. Oh, I really like that. And are you going to make videos about Black Desert Online? No. I also don't really have time to play another MMO, even though I would really like to play another one someday. You know, just go into an MMO without knowing everything and just relearning everything for the first time. That sounds like a lot of fun, but that also sounds like a very time-consuming thing, and I don't know if you guys know this, but making videos is a very time-consuming process. And if I have free time, I usually spend it making more videos. Because there's videos I make that I expect to do reasonably well, and then there's videos I make for fun that I know won't do well. You know, Dave and DevBot. So I spend my free time making videos. I also spend my work time making videos. So I'm always just making videos. And I'd have to cut into my making video times in order to start up a new game. But I would like to do that someday. I don't know if it'd be Black Desert Online, though. Next question. I wonder how much of your viewer base is EU and how much is NA. Who from the EU would watch my stuff? Next question. I know what the constant battle is with the stomach stuff and paints. Been trying to switch my diet around forever and nothing has worked. Still living to this day trying to find answers. Every doctor has told me the same thing about IBS or a million other things. I think this is in reference to the fact that I have IBS, or had it anyway. In the middle of February, like a day or two after Valentine's Day, I started having very bad pains in my sides. Like, to the point where I thought, like, oh, I probably have, like, a kidney stone or something. But I did have colon problems a year ago, so I thought it was probably that. So I took mineral oil and stuff, and that didn't work, and I went to the doctors, and they're like, you probably just have IBS. Just keep doing what you're doing. Change your diet. Keep taking mineral oil, and it'll probably go away. And I was like, okay. And then I went to another doctor, and he was like, well, here's some pills. Keep changing your diet. Work out more. And try these pills, they might help. And I tried the pills, and they actually just made things worse. But I took all of them anyway, because it's like, well, he probably knows what he's talking about, since he's a doctor, and I'm not. So I did all the doses, which is for like 2 weeks, and then after those were over, I just went back to mineral oil only. Because I stopped taking it for a while, and then I started taking it again in the middle while I was taking the pills as well. And then like a week after I stopped taking the pills, I started feeling better again. The pills didn't really help at all. And then, like, a week ago, I finally stopped feeling pains in my sides. So, that was, like, what, in the middle of April? And the symptoms started in the middle of February, so. I was in pain for about 2 months. That's a pretty long time, I guess. But, I mean, they did finally go away. And I am grateful for that. So, it was probably just IBS. Irritable bowel syndrome, and, I'm glad the pain went away, because I read lots of horror stories about people who had to just live with IBS for years at a time. And I thought that was probably the case too, because, you know, after having pains for over a month, you start thinking, well, this is probably going to stay here forever. Luckily, they're gone now, but I still have to change my diet and everything, and I still take mineral oil, you know, just in case. I don't want it to come back. So I have lots of dietary restrictions, and I can't eat junk food anymore. And I really miss eating chips. Oh man, what I wouldn't give to, you know, no. That's it for the video. If you have any questions you want me to answer, I'll answer pretty much anything. Just don't ask if I'm gay or something, because I'm not. I don't think about men and their biceps or feminine penises.